But we will start now anyway. So first of all, a warm welcome. My name is Toon van Acht. I'm the chairman of Open Knowledge Belgium. And as you find out, we're speaking English and we're on the other side of the language barrier for many people in the room. Alors, welcome, bienvenue, willkommen. Le reste de la journée sera en français. Je sais qu'il y a beaucoup de fonctionnaires francophones dans la salle. But we also have people coming from the Netherlands, and so we chose the lowest common denominator to be English. So I have actually 15 minutes, 30 slides, so fasten your seatbelts, here we go. Open Belgium, I see many people who've been here previous years, but this is your first time. We actually try to connect people from the open community, government officials, researchers, academics, and industrial influencers, people who make their living with open data. For those who don't know it, open knowledge, we fight for a world where knowledge creates power for the many, not the few. That's our main core value, I would say. And first question by show of hands, because I want to open this opening address with a little joke about address data. Who feels that your home address is theirs too? Who's very privacy aware? You can show your hand if you feel that way. Do you feel that your personal address, so your street, your number of your house, the city code and the city, that without being, whether it's yours as well because you own the house or the apartment? Wow. We do have a dozen names and some doubters going up, because actually it might feel that way, but it's not. It's only metadata. It is only something that points to geospatial coordinates. Same thing like we have with LIDAR. LIDAR is these planes flying over your house with lasers that can get the volume of everything. And the reason I'm pointing this out, that we have this upcoming GDPR law that you heard a lot about already, and it's being used as an excuse to not open data sets. And that's why we open with this one, because an address, it looks so simple, and yet it is so complicated. It's being made by the commune, like la ville, the city where you live, is being fed into your region's database, which is then being consolidated in a national database, and which is creating huge societal and economic impact to know where you live, to route all those packages you order on the internet, for the government to know where you are. To give one example, if you think you own it, well, the government can change it, and actually 300,000 Flemish citizens will get a new address 1st of January 2019. Many are unaware of it today, because we are merging cities. And by merging cities, for example, Neerpelt, Overpelt become Pelt. They both have Place Communale, Rue de l'Église, the Kerkstraat, het Gemeenteplein. There's lots of duplicates in all those cities, and so they will all get renamed. And so this metadata layer is getting renamed, which is a huge headache for everybody pointing to those addresses. And this is just one example how something that seems very simple is very complicated, because it's changing all the time and it needs to be interoperable between all those levels. And that to us is what open data is about, is by using these things, this metadata, in a very efficient way, where you have one authentic source and where others can reuse it, both within their government as in the private industry and society. Now, this is an update. It's a bit of a shocking update, maybe, to some of you, but this is the slide that was shown by François Dumortier, who's heading the Best Address Committee, and who's actually taking care to make sure that all these new addresses are ending up in this federal database. And you can see that Flanders, of course, they have this unique project going on 1st of January, is pretty advanced already. They have like 89% of the new address formats validated. We can see that Wallonia is coming up, and I hope a lot of people in the room here are making sure that they will also make those deadlines. And we said that Brussels still has a long way to go, 0% validated yet. So everybody in this room, this basic thing called an address still has a long way to go. Now, we change our address, and all of you are welcome in B Central, and this is interesting. I don't need to give you our address. I can tell you we're up in the central station of Brussels. No need for a GPS to find that. Yeah. Now, this was very interesting, because when we changed our address, Pieter Kolkpaert, my fellow board member, he was like, yeah, isn't it absurd? My private address has to be published in the Moniteur Belge, the public state gazette. Why does my privacy have to be unlocked this way? And of course, we're saying, yeah, that's right. We want privacy for everybody else and for ourselves. But on the other hand, we also like it to be open. I'm thinking about Gial in Brussels with recent, or Samu Social, or all the recent scandals with Landinvest in Antwerp. I mean, we like data to be opened for people to be accountable, especially if they use government money. And on the other hand, we don't like our own data to be opened, yeah? And of course, it's very hard to make that mix when we want it to be open for the good and when we want it to be closed for the good, yeah? And so this is, I found this a very interesting discussion. By the way, if there's people from the food economy, I want to give you a thumbs up, because they actually replied, yes, just on an open tweeting, yes, you should publish your birth date and your address if you are a board member of a nonprofit. So any of you in the room who has such a role, your privacy is worth less than that of another citizen who's not active in ISBLs.
Yes, but we choose.
But you choose to, some people knowingly choose for it. Peter found out that we needed this data to publish it. He was like, oh, why do you need this? Why do we need to disclose this? Is this logical? That's the debate we want to have, yeah? And there is a very cultural dimension. I see a few, the Dutch people in the room, put up your hands. I see a few, wow, we have a big delegation from the Netherlands. Welcome allemaal. Good that you found it. In Holland, every citizen can check for every single license plate these data. How much does the car cost? How much taxes do you pay for it? What is the ecological classification of the car? Is it a polluting diesel or electric car? Is the license plate stolen or not? In Belgium, we go like, ooh, no, if you want to use license plates, the privacy commission will come down on you. Even a city needs to negotiate with them how and when they can use the license plates. In the Netherlands, one border away, this is open, and it had a positive effect. The positive effect was that the theft of fuel in gas stations went down, because those cameras that were already there are now checking, is this license plate stolen, and does the license plate correspond to the type of car to which it belongs according to the official authentic database? An unexpected positive use of what is to be considered public data in the Netherlands. Now, this has a societal impact, because we're always talking about these data, and in open knowledge we get the question, yeah, but what does it bring to society? Well, it can bring a lot. A simple thing as a license plate linked to the type of engine and combustion engine can help you to get polluting cars out of your cities. And this is, of course, a debate we're going to be having more and more. German cities are now allowed to decide themselves which type of cars they let in or out their city centers. But for that, you need to know what the car is actually using as an engine. So again, this brings us to the next phase. These are old school cars with combustion engines. The new ones are data factories. A self-driving car is generating it has so many sensors and is generating so much data that we definitely need to have a debate, what's gonna happen to all those data? Can we reuse them? Yeah? It has image recognition in it. We're very concerned what happened with cameras. Well, those cars are filming all the time and they're interpreting themselves with algorithms that we don't know what and how they decide. Here's a nice little moral dilemma. Your self-driving cars and the brakes are broken. It detects that. And it has three options to crash. It can choose the hard wall, killing probably the passenger. It can take the elderly gentleman instead of Christmas trees that will kill the gentleman, break the thing, and the passenger will get. Or it can take the children in a field, not hurting the passenger, but killing two children. Now, of course, when we see this, each of you has a choice which dilemma you want. But we don't know what the car will do, and it's programmed. It is using data that is interpreting to make a moral choice. And the next choice is, do we want the car owner to be able to select a mode, high survival mode? Yeah, or not. And this debate is something that we would very much like to happen publicly, because the cars are out there and there is very little debate about this. And when you talk about these data sets that are live and interpreted, you can go to legal data where we have robot judges or many other ways where administrations are profiling and using data to make moral choices. To, yes, give somebody a subvention or financial support or not, or to send somebody to jail or not, and so on. So we would like to have open benchmarks, where you can say, if this goes in as a society, we would like that to go out. Here's another call we would like to make. If you, as a city or a regional or government, have to give a license to somebody to operate on your territory, a great recent example are those free-floating bikes, as they call them, the undocked bikes. Foreign companies come to our cities, they just dump 1,000 bikes, and then you can pick them up if you have the right app and you pay a few cents per minute to use them. It's a great initiative. It's helping for mobility. But before you know it, you have five operators on your territory, and they're like cluttering your streets. You know those images from China where they're piling up in the streets because they're broken and nobody takes them away. We would like governments to require those providers to share the data, which would allow others to consolidate those data sets to get into better interoperable applications and integrations in software. Here's a very small example. It goes from cars to parkings to public transport authorities, to bikes. This is the current state of openness of our public transport providers in Belgium. Yeah? Many have opened, and some of them, and a big round of applause to tech if they're in the room, they have a really open license. The real-time data are not open everywhere yet. We're still struggling to get the real-time positions. If we would have those real-time positions of public transport, and you know where all the bikes are, or for people who want to come with a car and swap, if the parking data would be open of the nearest data, all that would be used in a much more efficient way. And so we hope that there is openness so that it's not just one or two tech conglomerates that can sort of swipe everything up and make you even more sticky in their apps than they are today, but that to have an open, non-locked-in ecosystem. Open access is the principle that if a government subsidizes research, that the research itself should be opened without you having to pay for it to a subscription magazine, and that the underlying research data would be opened as well. There's a lot of uncertainty going on. What do we have to expect? There has been an announcement of the European Open Science Cloud, and there is currently a new open access provision being written for the Belgian copyright law. If you know more about that, or you want to know our opinion about it, please talk to Inge. She's sitting here in the second row, waving up her hand. She's our expert in those matters, and Gwen Frank, if she's around, she's in the back of the room, you can talk to her too about that. So, copyright law. Recent paper by the Flemish Inter-University, Reasons to Open, Reasons to Close. Yeah, so there's very interesting research being published why academics actually say they want to or don't want to open their research. Now, for many years we've been asking governments to provide us an open data feedback loop. If reusers of open data find errors, please give them a way to communicate those errors to you. It's a very cheap way to get immediate corrections on the open data sets you publish. Don't be afraid to open your data set because you say it's not perfect yet. It will never be perfect. But by opening it, at least you expose it and you will learn what other people can help you with to correct it. Not only governments should open. I think with the sensor and the IoT revolution happening, citizens are opening data, air quality in their houses and other things like that. Companies can open data, electricity companies, about the average use in a certain street. So again, it's anonymized, in that case non-personal data, that you can use for a societal good cause. Here's some good news. For many years, Open Knowledge has been building the Open Data Index. It's being published this year. This 2017-18 will come out, I think it's going to be June. But there is a revision cycle that has been introduced. Because of our complex Belgian state, we often have like Flanders complaining, why is this score so low? Because at this level, they didn't implement it yet, and so Belgium scores low, but we did everything we could. This is just one example. So from now on, we have the possibility to give feedback and to maybe balance that a little bit better between 0 and 1, and to say, yeah, those levels have already done that. So that's something about the Open Data Index. We do have some concerns. Many good things have happened over the last year. As Open Knowledge, we're very happy to see that the PSI directive has been implemented in all legislative bodies and at all levels. So this was a big effort. We see that many government officials still struggle to really get the mindset to open data sets if they can open them. And we see currently that GDPR is being used as the upcoming excuse not to open. Yeah, but somebody can complain about this data that they might feel is personal, so we're not going to open the data set until we have case law about it. No, please don't. The GDPR doesn't change that much. It gives the Privacy Commission a stick, and there is a very clear European framework now, but these things, you were already not allowed to breach people's privacy. So in that respect, it doesn't change that much for you as a government. And then the last dangerous evolution we see is that we see new private gatekeepers, the government giving away the keys to public information. One recent example, 1st of March, was the great resource FiscoNet. For those of you who want to know more about it, taxes, The SPF Finance had a great public portal, Fisconet, and they have now used a tool that Boza has put at their disposal, which was a private cloud, and we have nothing against Microsoft or SharePoint, but if you want to go to Fisconet now, you need to have a Microsoft account. When I registered, I needed to put in my birth date, email address, and so on. And so this is the government giving away, and this is not to get private information. I don't need to get my pension or I don't need to log in. This is just public information of civic servants who are publishing about fiscal data, and the government giving away the key to a private company. So we very much ask the government, if you have open data portals and open public data, do not put them behind a private paywall and a login at the American company. I already got a terms and conditions update since doing this 1st of March. So this is Microsoft telling me we've just upgraded the TNC for a government website. So a very weird position if you ask me. I'm closing with a call for you at the break later on. We have Mirva on that side over there about the recognition of skills. We have Open Summer of Codes on that side, which is where we really would like to get more, especially French-speaking and Walloon companies and governments involved. This is during summer. We give students the paid opportunity to develop do-good projects, and we have companies and governments who subvention that. And so Open Summer of Codes, talk to Dries if you want to know more about it. OpenStreetMap has a booth on that side as well, and we see Ben, you can talk to him as the OpenStreetMap guru, of one of the gurus in Belgium on that project. And we have Digital Wallonia, who's coming up now. They have their booth too, and we want to really thank them for the opportunity to be able to host it here, and for them supporting us also financially to allow this day to have a low ticket price. So without further ado, again, I thank you for being here. We have an exciting day and program ahead, and Benoît Huc, I invite you on stage to try to recover some of that time of our program. He promised me it's going to be a 5-minute talk, so good luck with that.